Ông quỳ chỗ. Ông nhung nhung rẻ. ក៏ទៅដំណើរការនីតិវិធីសម្រាប់ការនៅថ្ងៃនេះ
សូមគោរពលោកប្រធានសម្រាប់សម្មនាការនៅថ្ងៃនេះក៏ឡើងជីកាត់សម្គាល់ឃើញថាគ្រប់ភាគីទាំងអស់នៃរឿងក្តីនេះមានវត្តមានដោយឡែកលោកនួនជាមានវត្តមាននៅបន្ទប់ឃុំខ្លួនខាងក្រោមសារសម្មនាការនេះដោយលោកស្នើសុំលះបង់សិទ្ធិមានវត្តមានដោយផ្ទាល់ពីបន្ទប់សម្មនាការសាក់សីដែលត្រូវមកផ្ដល់សក្ខីកម្មនៅថ្ងៃនេះគឺលោករីឆាតឌុតម៉ែនតាមរយៈប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍ពីសហរដ្ឋអាមេរិកសាក់សីបានបញ្ជាក់ថាតាមសមត្ថភ
តទាំងពីររូបគឺលោកនួនជានិងលោកខៀវសំផនឬភាគីដើមមិនដឹងរដ្ឋប្បវេណីណាមួយដែលត្រូវបានទទួលស្គាល់នៅក្នុងរឿងក្តីនេះទេសក្តិសិទ្ធិរូបនេះនឹងធ្វើសម្បត្តិនៅចំពោះមុខអង្គជំនុំជម្រះនៅក្នុងអំឡុងពេលនៃការផ្ដោតសិក្ខាកម្មនេះផងដែរគឺមានលោកថតលូវែលដែលជាជំនួយការមេធាវីនិងលោកជេសិនបារ៉េតជាមេធាវីរបស់សក្តិសិទ្ធិតាមការបញ្ជាក់ពីផ្នែកបច្ចេកទេសសោតួបានជួយដំណឹងថាការរៀបចំផ្នែកបច្ចេកទេសសម្រាប់ការស្ដាប់សក្ខាកម្មនៅពេលនេះបានរៀបចំរួចរាល់អស់ហើយរីឯសាក់សីបានត្រៀមខ្លួនរួចជាស្រេចសម្រាប់ការផ្ដល់សក្ខាកម្មនេះសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធាន
អរគុណកញ្ញាជាស៊ីហងដែលជាដំបងនេះអង្គជំរះសម្រាប់លើសម្ដៅសុំរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាជាមុនសិនអង្គជំរះបានទទួលលិខិតសុំលះបង់សិទ្ធិចូលរួមក្នុងសកម្មភាពដែលផ្ទាល់ក្នុងបន្ទប់សកម្មភាពនេះរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាចុះថ្ងៃទី31ខែមីនាឆ្នាំ2015ដែលបានបញ្ជាក់ថាដោយគាត់មានបញ្ហាសុខភាពឈឺក្បាលឈឺចង្កេះមិនអាចអង្គុយយូរបានមិនអាចផ្ចង់អារម្មណ៍បានយូរនឹងដើម្បីមានលទ្ធភាពចូលរួមសកម្មភាពនេះថ្ងៃមុខឲ្យមានប្រសិទ្ធភាពខ្លួនសូមលះបង់សិទ្ធិចូលរួមនឹងមានវត្តមានដោយផ្ទាល់ក្នុងបន្ទប់សកម្មភាពនៅថ្ងៃទី31នៅថ្ងៃទី30ខែមីនាឆ្នាំ2015មេធាវីកាពីក្តីរបស់ខ្លួនបានជម្រាបអំពីផលប៉ះពាល់នៃការលះបង់សិទ្ធិនេះថាការលះបង់សិទ្ធិនេះมันអាចបកស្រាយថាជាការលះបង់សិទ្ធិក្នុងការកាត់សេចក្តីដែលយុត្តិធម៌ឬក៏សិទ្ធិក្នុងការចំទាស់ទៅនឹងភ័ស្តុតាងក្នុងការដាក់បង្ហាញឬដាក់ជូនតុលាការនេះគ្រប់ពេលវេលានៃលើរូបខ្លួនឡើយបានឃើញហេតុកំណត់ហេតុពិនិត្យសុខភាពជូនជាប់ចោតនួនជាធ្វើឡើងដោយគ្រូពេទ្យប្រចាំការពិនិត្យព្យាបាលថែទាំសុខភាពជូនជាប់ចោតនួនជានៅអវតកចុះថ្ងៃទី30ខែមីនាឆ្នាំ2015បានគាត់សម្គាល់ថាស្ថានភាពសុខភាពរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាមានអាការៈឈឺចង្កេះរ៉ាំរ៉ៃវិលមុខមិនអាចអង្គុយយូរបាននិងផ្ដល់អនុសាសន៍ថាសូមអង្គជំរះអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យនួនជាចូលរួមតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសកម្មភាពពីចម្ងាយពីបន្ទប់ខាងក្រោមសាលសកម្មការនេះផ្អែកលើមូលដ្ឋាននេះនិងយោងតាមបទបញ្ញត្តិនៃប្រធាន81/5នៃប្រធានផ្ទៃក្នុងអវតកអង្គជំរះយល់ព្រមនិងអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យជនជាប់ចោតនួនជានៅបន្តតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសកម្មភាពពីចម្ងាយពីបន្ទប់ឃុំខ្លួនមួយស្ថិតនៅក្រោមសាលសកម្មការនេះតាមរយៈឧបករណ៍សោទស្សន៍សម្រាប់រយៈពេលសកម្មភាពពេញមួយថ្ងៃនេះដែលលោកនួនជាលះបង់សិទ្ធចូលរួមក្នុងកិច្ចដំណើរការសកម្មភាពដែលផ្ទាល់នៅក្នុងបន្ទប់សកម្មភាពនេះហើយបង្កប់ឲ្យបុគ្គលិកផ្នែកសោទស្សន៍ភ្ជាប់ប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍សម្រាប់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាអាចចូលរួមនឹងតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសកម្មភាពពីចម្ងាយពីបន្ទប់ឃុំខ្លួនមួយស្ថិតនៅក្រោមសាលសកម្មការនេះក្នុងរយៈពេលនៃដំណើរការសកម្មការសម្រាប់ថ្ងៃនេះអង្គជំរះសូមជម្រាបសួរលោកថូតលូវែល
Good morning
ជម្រាបសួរលោកប្រធាន
Look, Richard, Dudman, Dudman, there.
I didn't understand that.
Richard Dudman, look, but then, come up,
But on Jumrah Som Su, they look at Toad Toad Wild Jimun, the May Mirip Jun Satin at Jun Trip, and be what the mean the bar.
Good morning, this is Todd Lowell. I'm an assistant United States attorney with the Department of Justice for the United States for the District of Maine.
But Okun, hey, just look, Manette, look, Shmuay.
My name is Jason Barrett, Richard Dudman's attorney, the law firm of Eaton Peabody in Bangor, Maine.
Ma, Okun, hey, from the big picky and Satin at Junta, that I need here, no jet local Satsay Dudman, mean amid the region, don't be rook, local Towell, Hainung, local Jason, Barrett. ដែលជាមេធាវីផ្ទាល់របស់សាក់សីហើយគាត់ចូលរួមនៅក្នុងកិច្ចដំណើរការសកម្មភាពនៅថ្ងៃនេះក្នុងនៃពិនិត្យមើលលទ្ធភាពផ្នែកខាងសុខភាពរបស់លោកមេធាវីឌុតម៉ែននៅក្នុងឡុងពេលផ្ដល់សក្តិកម្មចំពោះមុខអង្គជនរួមជម្រះសាលាដំបងបាទអរគុណលោកថូថូវែលហើយនិងលោកជេសិនបារ៉េត
Thank
you. I'm
Richard Dudman.
Richard Dudman. កើតនៅថ្ងៃខែឆ្នាំណា
I didn't understand the question.
ខ្ញុំអត់យល់សំណួរលោកធាន
ថ្ងៃខែឆ្នាំកំណើតរបស់លោក តើ លោក បាច់ប្រាប់ដល់អង្គជំនះបានដែរទេ អំពីថ្ងៃខែឆ្នាំកំណើតរបស់លោក
I was born May 3rd 1918 96 years ago. My present address is in Ellsworth, Maine. The street is 7070 Surrey Road, S-U-R-R-Y Road, in Ellsworth, E-L-L-S-W-O-R-T-H, Maine, 04605.
Look, Richard,
I didn't understand that. Current address. My current address is what I just told you. I'll tell you again. It's number 70 Surrey Road, spelled S-U-R-R-Y Road, in the city of Ellsworth, E-L-L-S-W-O-R-T-H, Maine,
04605. Ma okun lok
I am a freelance writer. That means a self-employed writer. My nationality? I'm an American, United States of America citizen.
លោកដូចមែនក្នុងនាមលោកជាសាក្សីដែលត្រូវផ្ដល់សក្ខីកម្មនៃចំពោះមុខអង្គជំរះនាពេលនេះអង្គជំរះតម្រូវឲ្យលោកធ្វើសម្បត្តិតាមជំនឿសាសនារបស់លោកជាមុនសិនតើលោកយល់ព្រមដែរឬទេ
He's asking for the oath.
Can you take an oath?
I can take an oath.
Shall I do it now?
លោករីឆាតដូចមែនលោករូជឺភីលីបសូមលោកណែនាំលោកដូចមែនឲ្យធ្វើសម្បត្តិតាមជំនឿសាសនារបស់គាត់នៅចំពោះមុខអង្គជំរះ
Mr. Dudman, please repeat the entire oath after me. I solemnly declare that I will speak the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
I solemnly declare that I will speak the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Thank you.
អរគុណលោករីឆាតដូចមែនតាមរបាយការណ៍របស់កឡាមជីសាមណាកាអម្បាញ់មិញនេះថាតាមតាមតម្រិតភាពដែលលោកអាចដឹងលោកមិនមានជាប់ចំណងញាតលោហិតឬញាតពុនជាមួយនឹងជនជាប់ចោតនឹងពីររូបគឺនួនជានិងខៀវសំផនទេហើយក៏មិនជាប់ញាតចំណងញាតលោហិតឬញាតពុនជាមួយនឹងបុគ្គលដែលត្រូវទទួលយកជាដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋពលរីនៅក្នុងត្រង់រឿងសូសូពីនេះដែរតើពិតមែនដែរឬទេ
That is correct.
សាក់សីពិតជាត្រឹមត្រូវលោកប្រធានបាទអរគុណហើយអង្គជំរះសូមជម្រាបជូនអំពីសិទ្ធក្នុងការណៃកិច្ចរបស់លោកដូចមែនក្នុងនាមលោកជាសាក់សីក្នុងកិច្ចដំណើរការសាមណការនៃចំពោះមុខអង្គជំរះលោកអាចបដិសេធនៅក្នុងការឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងសំណួរឬសូមឲ្យលោកធ្វើអត្ថាធិប្បាយណាមួយឬច្រើនដែលដាក់ពីរដ្ឋភាពលើខ្លួនឯង សិទ្ធមិនធ្វើសក្ខីកម្មប្រឆាំងខ្លួនឯងហើយករណីយកិច្ចក្នុងនាមលោកជាសាក្សីដែលត្រូវផ្ដល់សក្ខីកម្មនៃចំពោះមុខអង្គជំរះនាពេលនេះលោកត្រូវឆ្លើយតបរាល់សំណួរទាំងឡាយដែលភាគីឬចៅក្រមនៃអង្គជំរះសួរចំពោះលោកហើយលោកជាសាក្សីត្រូវតែឆ្លើយតែការណាដែលពិតដែលលោកបានដឹងបានឮបានឃើញបានធ្វើឬបានចងចាំឬក៏ធ្លាប់មានបទពិសោធន៍ជួបប្រទះឬបានធ្វើការសង្កេតដោយផ្ទាល់នៅព្រឹត្តិហេតុ ហេតុការទាំងឡាយដែលលោកពាក់ដែលពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងសំណួរដែលភាគីឬជាក្រុមសួរលោកលោកដូចមែនតែលោកធ្លាប់ប្រោតកិច្ចសម្ភារជាមួយនឹងអ្នកមន្ត្រីស៊ើបអង្កេតនៃការិយាល័យសហជាក្រុមស៊ើបអង្កេតនៃអង្គជំរះវិសាមញ្ញក្នុងតុលាការកម្ពុជាដែរឬទេរយៈពេលកន្លងមក
I I didn't get the question.
បាទអរគុណហើយខ្ញុំបញ្ជាក់ម្ដងទៀតតើលោកធ្លាប់បានផ្ដល់សក្ខីកម្មនៅចំពោះមុខអ្នកស៊ើបអង្កេតនៃការិយាល័យសហក្រមស៊ើបអង្កេតដែរឬទេនៃអង្គនៃអង្គជំនះវិសាមញ្ញក្នុងតុលាការកម្ពុជាកាលរយៈពេលកន្លងមក
No.
បាទអរគុណហើយអង្គជំរះសូមជម្រាបលោករីឆាតដូចមែនថាក្នុងអំឡុងពេលដែលលោកផ្ដោតសក្តិកម្មប្រសិនបើលោកត្រូវការឈប់សម្រាកនាពេលណាមួយនោះសូមលោកជម្រាបមកអង្គជំរះបានដឹងជាមុនដើម្បីអង្គជំរះលើកពេលវេលាសម្រាប់ឈប់សម្រាកនៅពាក់កណ្ដាលទីដែលលោកត្រូវការឈប់សម្រាកលោកយល់ទេ
Yes maybe about 45 minutes from now something like that would be fine for my for me
45 នាទីក្រោយពីខ្ញុំដល់ស្ទេកម្មនេះអាចឈប់សម្រាកម្ដងគឺអត់អីទេសម្រាប់ខ្ញុំអាចធ្វើអញ្ចឹងបានត្រឹម45នាទីសម្រាប់ម្ដង
បាទអរគុណហើយជាអង្គជំរះសូមប្រគល់វិទ្យការជូនទៅសហមេធាវីការពារក្តីជូនចាប់ចោតនួនជាដើម្បីតាំងសំណួរដេញដោលចំពោះសាក់សីរីឆាដូចមែនមុនភាគីដទៃទៀតនៃរឿងក្តីហើយក្រុមមេធាវីការពារក្តីនួនជាមានពេលវេលា1ម៉ោង20នាទីក្នុងការសួរដេញដោលសាក់សីរីឆាដូចមែនសូមអញ្ជើញលោកមេធាវី
Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning, Your Honours. Good morning, Council. Mr. President, before I start, I would like to tell you that the Khmer Sampan team generously allots some time of them to us. So I would be hoping that I could ask questions to the witness for about 2 hours, maybe a bit.
Here's a question.
Good evening, Mr. Dudman.
Good evening.
My name is Victor Koppe. I am the international co-counsel for Nguyen Chia, and I would like to ask you some questions. Mr. Dudman, I would like to ask you some questions. Dudman, good evening. Did you hear me?
I can hear you, yes. Speak very distinctly and rather slowly, if you please.
I most certainly will, Mr. Dudman. Mr. Dudman, please allow me, for reasons of time, to very briefly summarize your CV.
And
if I make a mistake, please correct me. As already mentioned by you, you were born in 1918,
I think
in a month of the year when the First World War was still raging. I think you graduated at Stanford University in 1940, majoring in journalism. I believe you were also a Navy officer in the Second World War. I believe you started working as a journalist in 1949 and that you did that for 31 consecutive years. I believe, Mr. Dudman, that you have for instance, covered the revolution in Cuba, the assassination of President Kennedy, Watergate, I believe the war in Vietnam, and many other conflicts in the world.
In
1970, I think you spent 40 days in captivity of the Viet Cong in Cambodia, and in 1993 you received the George Polk Lifetime Achievement Award, which I believe is a prestigious American Journalism Award. Mr. Dudman, please allow me to say that I'm very impressed with your credentials and that I'm absolutely thrilled that at the age of almost 97 years old, you are still willing and able to testify as a witness before this tribunal. Now, Mr. Dudman, in this very, very brief summary made for purposes of your testimony, is this summary an adequate summary, or would you like to add something?
I think that covers my career. Actually, I started as a reporter sometime before 1949, but aside from that, I think you have accurately summarized my career.
Thank you, Mr. Dudman. I have a few short follow-up questions regarding your CV. Would you be able to tell the trial chamber why it was that you were awarded the Journalism Award that I mentioned earlier?
I don't know. It was their own judgment.
I understand, but I'm sure that when you were awarded this, given this award, that you were told as to what the reasons were that you received this journalism award.
I said I was a good reporter.
Thank you, Mr. Dudman. My next question would be, could you describe in some detail your work as a journalist when it comes to covering the U.S. involvement in Vietnam and Cambodia in the 70s of the last century?
My editor sent me repeatedly to Vietnam and Cambodia on many trips, and I stayed for periods of a few weeks usually, and wrote many articles about the various conflicts.
Do you remember how often you were in Indochina in the 70s?
Oh, maybe a dozen times.
Mr. Dudman, could you tell us some more about your 40 days captivity by members of the Viet Cong in Cambodia? And I don't mean details about the 40 days, because I read your very interesting book on this, but how it impacted your understanding and knowledge of the civil war in Cambodia between 1970 and 1975.
I, I don't understand your question.
You were held, as I mentioned earlier, in captivity in Cambodia, 40 days by members of the National Liberation Front of South Vietnam, the Viet Cong. You wrote a book about this. Would you be able to tell us some more about how these days of captivity affected your views on the then raging civil war within Cambodia?
I would summarize it by saying that I learned firsthand that the Viet Cong people who held me were actually friendly and helpful, and I saw them as individuals rather than some kind of faceless enemy.
And did it somehow change your understanding of the civil war that was going on in Cambodia itself, or is that difficult to say after so many years?
I don't think I can remember how my thinking changed, if it did.
Thank you, Mr. Dudman. Following up on this question, at the time, I mean in the 70s and in subsequent years, did you consider yourself to be an expert on Vietnam and Vietnamese foreign policy?
An expert? Never really an expert. I was always learning.
Correct. But did you have relatively more expertise when it comes to speaking about Vietnamese foreign policy than other journalists, or would that be difficult for you to
assess? I covered the State Department, I covered policy speeches and actions, and I don't know how to answer you beyond that.
I realize it's a bit difficult question, so Mr. Dudman, allow me to move on. And allow me to move on to the year 1990, actually 25 years ago. And I would like to go to that year, Mr. Dudman, because on the 17th of August 1990, you wrote an op-ed, an article to the New York Times. Do you remember having written that article in the New York Times?
I did not remember it, but the document was produced for me tonight, and I have it before me, but I have not reread it.
Would it be an idea to give you a few minutes to have a look at it, or do you prefer me to ask questions about it so that you can reply to it off the cuff, so to speak?
If you want to give me a moment, I will read it right now to myself. I'll do that.
Yes, please do, Mr. Dutton.
Yeah. Thank you.
while the witness is reading, Mr. President, I'm talking about document E307/5.2.16, ERN English 0100-2091, and French ERN 0107-2646, and Khmer ERN 0107-7091 up until 94.
I have finished reading the article.
Thank you very much, Mr. Dudman. I realize I'm asking you something about almost 25 years ago, but do you recall what prompted you to write this op-ed in the New York Times?
Do you recall writing the article?
Yes, do you remember what prompted you to write that op-ed?
I didn't get the questions.
My question was, do you recall the reason you wrote this article? What prompted you to write this op-ed?
Yes, I do.
Could you please tell us, Mr.
Dudman? I had visited Cambodia. I had been told by many people at home and elsewhere what I should think about it. As a reporter, I wanted to see for myself and make my own decision and not just write what I was told I should look for. I looked for signs of brutality. I found them. I looked for signs of mass extermination of people. I was told of some incidents, but not enough for me to judge. To make a wholesale judgment about mass murder. I don't know if you understand it, but a newspaper man always must maintain his skepticism about what he's told and to write what he sees and can learn. I did my best, and I don't know that I would write the same thing today, but that's what the way it struck me then, that's about all I can tell you about it.
In general terms, would you be able to say whether today you would still stand by the content of this article, this op-ed?
Since then, I have read a great deal about what went on under the Pol Pot regime, and I've talked to many sources about it too, and I doubt if I would have written this story knowing what I know today. But I must say the headline I think goes a little farther than the story, not much, but a little. I don't write my own headlines. That was the way I saw it at that time.
Allow me, Mr. Dudman, to read one or two excerpts from your article, and I would like to ask a few follow-up questions on exactly what you meant when you wrote it.
Yes.
Mr. President, I think I just mentioned the ERN, so I hope everyone has it in front of him or her. So the paragraph I would like to read to you is in the second column, Mr. Dudman, and it reads as follows. Before we abandon the opposition coalition, we should take another look at the man we love to hate, at the conventional wisdom. You have it?
Yeah.
At the conventional wisdom that Pol Pot and the Khmer Rouge are irrational fanatics who practiced deliberate genocide, slaughtered more than 1 million Cambodians, and wrecked the Cambodian society and economy. The evidence for these fixed beliefs consists mainly of pertinent, though statistically inconclusive, anecdotes and extrapolation from accounts of mass execution in a few villages. It comes mostly from those with an interest in blackening the name of the Khmer Rouge, from Cambodian refugees, largely the middle and upper class victims of the Pol Pot Revolution, and from the Vietnamese who long ago annexed much of Cambodia. Saigon was once a Cambodian city and now covered the rest. Hanoi knows the public relations game. Pol Pot and his hermit-like regime, on the other hand, have made almost no effort to tell their story. I just got a sign that I should slow down a little bit for translation, Mr. Dudman. My first question to you would be whether you remember what made you write that statistically inconclusive anecdotes coming mostly from those with an interest in blackening the name of the Khmer Rouge. Do you remember what prompted you to write this?
I don't recall the exact conversations I had, but I do remember being told such things, and I I said, as you quoted, that we should take another look. I think we have taken another look, and the preponderance of the evidence supports the fact that there was a mass murdering going on. So at the time, I was writing a normally skeptical reporter's view of what he could find out. And I know more things now than I did then.
One final question on this specific paragraph, Mr. Dudman. What did you mean when you wrote that Hanoi knows the public relations game and that Pol Pot made almost no effort to tell their story?
I don't remember what I, where I got that in that statement. I don't really recall. I can't deny I wrote it, but I don't remember why I wrote that.
Thank you, Mr. Dudman. Now, there is a second passage that I would like to read to you and then ask you, if that's all right with you, some questions. And that is a paragraph that actually reflects your visit in 1978 to Democratic Cambodia, and that is in the fourth column of your article, which starts with the word still. Allow me, Mr. Dudman, if you have found the specific passage, to read it to you. Still, the information I had received in advance was mostly misleading. Observing many hundreds of Cambodians, too many, I judged, to have been arranged for my benefit, I saw a generally healthy population, a normal demographic mix of men, women, and children, including babies in arms, and yes, many nursing mothers. I looked in vain for distended bellies and dull brownish hair. Working hours, 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. p.m. were not unreasonable for the harvest season. A natural rubber factory, a pharmaceutical plant, and a textile mill appeared to be operating efficiently. Rice exports had resumed on a modest scale, as confirmed later by the U.S. Department of Agriculture. Mr. Dudman, do you recall whether before writing this op-ed in the New York Times in 1990 that you reread your report, your 15 January 1979 report on your visit in 78? Did you reread that before your op-ed?
I didn't get that question. Will you rephrase it?
Of course, by all means. I just quoted you in your op-ed writing about your visit in 78. Do you recall that before you wrote this op-ed, you revisited or reviewed your own earlier report from 1979?
បានអានរបាយការណ៍មួយនៅក្នុងឆ្នាំ 1975
I don't recall relating this to the what I'd seen before. Those that paragraph you read starting still, I can remember writing that, and I can remember looking for those signs of abuse of the population, and I wrote what I saw.
Maybe I'll ask a different follow-up question. Do you feel that at the time you wrote your article in the New York Times that your 79 report was still an accurate reflection of what you had seen and experienced during your trip to DK, Democratic Kampuchea, in 78?
I really don't get the point of your question.
My question, I suppose, goes to understanding whether when you wrote your article in 1990 and quoted your own experiences from that visit, that was still an accurate reflection of what you had experienced yourself. In other words, did you revisit your 1979 report when you wrote this New York Times article in 1990?
There were two separate experiences. In 1978, I was physically threatened and could easily have been killed. In 1990, I was walking the streets looking for evidence that would support or call into question what I've been told to look for in Cambodia. I wrote what I saw. In both cases, I wrote what happened. I don't know if that answers your question, but that's my answer.
I'm only trying to find out that 11 years after your trip, you saw things differently in relation to your trip, whether you had somehow changed your mind about your trip in 1978, or whether in 1990 that was still reflecting your experiences. That was the reason of my question.
I didn't see a conflict between the two. I wrote in both cases, I wrote what I experienced and what I saw.
Thank you, Mr. Dudman. Another reason I'm asking you this question is because I asked your companion on the trip, Elizabeth Becker, also some questions on your op-ed, and she had read your op-ed, and she gave testimony, and I'm happy to quote the literal words, which seemed to be very critical about this article, basically saying that she didn't agree with what you had written. And maybe if you allow me, Mr. Dudman, I would read some of her answers, and then I would like to ask your reaction. So I asked Elizabeth Becker whether she had any, and I'm referring, Mr. President, to E1/260, That is a testimony of 10 February 2015, between 13:51 and 2 o'clock. And I asked her, do you have any general comments on that op-ed that Mr. Dudman wrote? She says, I disagree with it. By 1990, when it was published, all of the tool slang records had been tool slang had been open for years. The evidence was clear, and Dick had retired. He'd never gone back to Cambodia since December 78. And I like and admire Dick, and I was sorry to see that he wrote that because the evidence was the contrary. And some further, in her testimony, Mr. Dudman, Elizabeth Becker testified that his ideas are entirely out of date, that he doesn't even mention all of the archives that were uncovered after the Vietnamese invasion. But this was, there was no question, the reason we're having this trial now is the evidence is overwhelming. And as I said, I really like Dick and I admire him, and I'm very sorry to see he wrote that, because the evidence is was an incompetent, murderous regime. That is Mr. Dudman on one part of your testimony. On the other part, when you were saying the things on your visit, she testified, that is at 13:57, Mr. President, same day. This is what we call single source reporting, that when you go simply to a country and you allow government officials to make your itinerary, to define who you talk to and who do you not talk to, and do not allow you any freedom at all. That is single sourcing. That is not complete journalism, and I disagree, as you know. Mr. Dudman, I apologize for the long quotes, but I would simply like to give you an opportunity to react to Elizabeth Becker's criticism of your article in the New York Times.
What should I say? Who likes to be criticized? Nobody. I wrote what I saw on that trip, and I was writing normal journalistic skepticism and looking for myself, and I wrote what I saw, and I resented when I'm told I was doing single source reporting. I don't know what single source she's talking about.
I'm not sure either, Ms. Dudman, but that's her testimony. But if I would sum it up in one sentence, it seems that one of her main criticisms is that you had not in fact seen Cambodia before, and that you weren't in the position to compare what you saw with earlier experiences. What would be your reaction to that?
I didn't get that question.
I'm sorry, I will rephrase. It seems that Elizabeth Becker was criticizing you here in this court while saying that you hadn't seen Cambodia before your visit in 1978, and that you weren't in a position to make any comparisons as to the food situation, the general health situation, as opposed to her who had visited Cambodia before.
Well, she's been in Cambodia a lot more than I have, so she has a longer perspective. I had two main experiences there. Well, three, I guess. being captured, being threatened in 78, and revisiting it and seeing for myself. And I, in each case, I wrote what I saw and what I experienced.
Is there anything in your report of 79, Mr. Dudman, that you would now consider as being too positive or too uncritical as to what you have seen and experienced on your trip?
Yes, for everything I read since, and everything and sources that I have consulted, I think that there was a genocide under the Pol Pot regime. So I wouldn't now write this article.
I apologize for my unclarity, but I was now referring to your 79 report. Oh, I see I have to break because of time.
ខ្ញុំមិនសរសេរអំពីហេតុការណ៍នេះទេ và lần này đọc về sầm rạ ông em bạc cả sầm rạ đọc đến ti rồi đọc mong phẩm buôn đọc đến ti xong mình chơi chơi với nhà bè bản tổ cái sầm rạ cả sầm rạ lúc đến mét đã sầm rạ đọc đến ti hãy đọc đến ti tiết chụp nè
sầm rạ cho